All right, just curious again, how many are Patriot fans? Patriot fans, let me see, Patriot fans. The evil empire, Patriot fans, okay. Falcon fans, Falcon fans. How many just frankly don't care? Yeah. Oh, man. I love World Vision, too. So glad Rusty and his crew are here. Hey, running a marathon, let me tell you, I've done a marathon. Now, you notice I didn't say run. I finished a marathon. I finished right before the police car who was closing up. Anybody can do it. And this is a great thing to do it with, man. They'll train you. They'll come along your side. They're a great encouragement. So let me encourage you. Think about doing that because what they're doing it for is really, really important in our world today. We're going to be texting at the end of the service. We'll close the service and those that want to stick around. The texting is a way for you to ask questions. It's a way for us to dialogue. Maybe something I'm going to say won't make sense. You want clarity on it? Something just going on that you want to ask? Maybe a question's come up in your small group, and then we'll take a couple of those and spend some time at the end of the service, and I'll answer those as they'll be up here on the screen so you can see them as well. So if you do that, the way you text here at Park is in your texting app. The phone number is 62953, 62953. And in the body of the text, you must put ask NN for Near North to make sure it gets here. I also want to say good morning to those that are watching us on live streaming. I don't know if you know, we usually have several hundred people who watch the services, engage with us through live streaming. So good morning to you. We've been in this Gospel of Mark, and the first several, eight chapters of the Gospel of Mark has been about the proclamation of the King. The King has come. The kingdom has come because the King has come. And we've seen the works of the kingdom as the King has come and he's healed and has raised the dead and cast out demons and how he's establishing his reign in the lives of people. Today, now, we begin to make a turn. And we make a turn to the story of the cross. And the second half of Mark is now about the cross and that Jesus is on his way to the cross. And that's what we'll be talking about from here on out and all the way to Easter. And when we read it, it seems like it's defeat. When really it's victory. It seems like it's just unnecessary suffering when really it's Jesus coming in his suffering, bringing something that no one else could bring in order that we might know eternal life. And we'll be looking at those as we process through. So turn with me to Mark 8, Mark 8 on page 844. Now you can't make this next story up. If you're gonna make up the Bible, I'm not sure you could make up this next story. It just wouldn't make sense outside the context in which it was written. What we have here is we have Jesus just getting finished feeding the 4,000. Let me show you a picture. Here's a map of the area. And what you see circled is probably where the feeding of the 4,000 took place. And it was probably he fed 4,000 Gentiles. You remember his ministry is primarily among Jews, but Jesus also goes amongst the Gentiles. And then he goes to Bethsaida. Now Bethsaida means literally the house of the fishermen, the house of the fishermen. Let me show you a picture. Here's a map. You see the arrow at the top showing you where the Jordan River comes out into the Sea of Galilee and then where Bethsaida would have been located. It was located on the Jordan River. Because it was a village of fishermen that would go down the Jordan River to fish in the Sea of Galilee. On the right is a house they found. They call it the fisherman's house because they found hooks and all kind of other fishing utensils in there, as well as some pools that you would have filled with water, and they would have kept the fish as they cleaned them to get them ready for market. Peter and Andrew were from Bethsaida, and so was a guy named Philip, who was one of the 12. Peter and Andrew, two of Jesus' closest friends, and Philip, one of his kind of inner circle as well. And so Jesus comes here, and as he walks into this village, it says he is met by a group of people who are bringing a blind man. These people cared, obviously, a great deal for this blind man, but they knew the reputation of Jesus. They knew that Jesus had healed a number of folks, and we've already looked at a number of stories. The paralytic that got lowered in the house, the woman who had had a blood disease for 12 years, Jairus' daughter who died that he raised from the dead, the demon-possessed man that Jesus cast the demons out of. I mean, there's just story after story after story of the King coming and establishing his kingdom in the lives of people. Well, they heard this. And they wanted the blind man to have an opportunity to engage with Jesus. They wanted Jesus to touch this blind man. In verse 23, it says that Jesus takes the blind man out of the city. He takes him away from the noise and the craziness. You can bet the disciples are with him because that was part of Jesus. He was always teaching. And what he does, he steps into the classroom, but the disciples don't know it. He's going to heal this blind man, but he's going to do it in such a way that he's going to teach something to these disciples. So what it says then is that Jesus spits in his eye. Now, spitting in America, that's pretty offensive. In fact, I found out this week you can be arrested for spitting on somebody. Why does Jesus spit? We're only told he spits three times. In John 9, he spits to make clay to put on a blind man that he sends to the pool of Siloam. In Mark 7, he spits on a man that is mute, that his tongue might be loosened. And now he spits on a blind man. Well, we're not really sure why he spits. There are writings for the time of rabbis, the religious teachers of the time, that talk about spit having some kind of power, and that the power of the oldest son in particular, and Jesus being the oldest son. I don't know. It could have been as simple of what, like my grandmother used to do. She would wet her hanky and rub some junk off my cheek. I mean, it could have been that Jesus is spitting to move some junk out of his eyes. We don't know. But then Jesus puts his hands on the man's eyes. And then he backs up and he says, what do you see? What do you see? Now you've looked down at verse 23, 24. The blind man says, well, I see people walking around, but they look like trees. Which tells us a couple things. One is that the man wasn't born blind, that he became blind, or he wouldn't know what a tree or a person would look like. But that it's only partial. Now, can you imagine the disciples standing around watching this happen? This is the only two-tier, two-stage healing of Jesus. Why does he do this? The disciples are probably freaking out. Is Jesus losing his power? Is he stuttering? You know, does Jesus go, oh, whoops, let me finish this? No, it's very purposeful in the why Jesus heals this way. Then Jesus puts his hands on his eyes again, and then it says in verse 25, it says, the man was able to see, and this is the important word, clearly, clearly. Then in verse 26, he tells them, don't go back to the village, but go home, but go home. Now, let me see if I can help us understand what's going on here. Do you remember John Mark? Mark is the one who wrote this. His name was John Mark, and we read about him several times in the New Testament. John Mark was a protege of Peter, Peter being one of Jesus' closest friends. And so John Mark went around as Peter talked about and told these stories and preached about Jesus. And so John Mark began to record these stories, and that's what we have in the Gospel of Mark. The Gospel of Mark is the only one who has this story. What I believe is that this is Peter making a statement. It's autobiographical. It's Peter going, I didn't know it at the time, but what Jesus did with that blind man is my story spiritually. It had been a very Jewish way for Jesus to heal in this way and not say a whole lot about it and let the disciples talk amongst themselves trying to figure it out. Why do you think he did that? I don't know. Why do you think he did that? Why was it only partial? That was the only time we've ever seen him do it kind of partial. And for them to dialogue about what is going on here. But what Jesus is saying, he's making a statement by the healing of this blind man of what their spiritual condition is like. What is true of them? They don't fully get who he is. Look with me at verse 21. Verse 21. Jesus has fed the 4,000. They're heading back to Bethsaida. And he says something to them, and they make all these excuses. And then Jesus says to him in verse 21, do you not yet understand? You don't get who I am yet. You've seen my miracles. You've seen the teaching. You've watched my character. We've spent every day together. You still don't get who I am and why I've come. You like the kingly elements I do, but you don't fully get why I've come. And look at verse 27. Right after the story, and Jesus went on with his disciples to the village of Caesarea Philippi, and on the way he asked his disciples, who do people say that I am? And we're going to see next week, Jason's going to come and share with us next week, that Peter doesn't get it. He doesn't get who Jesus is. There's a partial understanding for the disciples. Now maybe the story of the blind man is true for you too in your spiritual story. Maybe what is true of Peter, his recognition of that he understood Jesus kind of in stages, is true for some of us sitting in this room, that we too have come to know Jesus in stages. Now let's look at him. Let's look at the three pieces from this story. The first piece, the blindness, don't see. A blind man comes to Jesus, which talks about our spiritual blindness. Now, what is it that we don't see? We don't see our true condition, and we don't see Jesus and who he truly is. We don't recognize that we are spiritually rebellious and broken and damaged and sinful before God. And we don't fully recognize what it means then to also be a follower of Jesus. Spiritual blindness is true of every person ever born. We all start off in the same condition. We're spiritually blind. There is no one that has ever been born that woke up the first day in their birth hungering to know Jesus. There is no one. We all begin in the same place, that we are spiritually blind, and it comes because we are spiritually dead. Let me remind you of what we looked at a while back when we studied through the book of Ephesians. Ephesians 2, we'll put it up here on the screen. And you were dead in trespasses and sins in which you once walked, as Paul writes to the church in Ephesus, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh. Now, this is all of our starting point spiritually. We are spiritually dead. Now, what does that mean? We're unable, we're unwilling, and we're undeserving at this point. We're unable to see, we're unwilling to see. There's nothing in us that's stirring us to want to see Jesus. And frankly, we're undeserving of anything that God might do. That's true of every person ever born spiritually. We're spiritually dead, but then we also understand that we now are spiritually blind. Let's look at 2 Corinthians 4:4, and we'll put it up here on the screen. Paul writes to the church in Corinth, which is in modern-day Greece. And in their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. The evil one's job is to keep us blind. The evil one is not victorious if we worship the evil one. That's not where his victory is. His victory is if we just don't worship Jesus. If we just don't see Jesus, he finds great satisfaction. His job is to keep us blind. But thankfully, it is Jesus' job to make us see. And Jesus is stronger and he's greater. It's not just atheists and agnostics and those that define themselves in that growing group called nuns, N-O-N-E-S, who are blind. We saw last week, Jason shared with us, that the religious leaders of the day were blind, that religious people can be blind, that we can be so involved in the activity of the church, we can be so engaged in us thinking we're doing right things, important things, and yet be completely blind to who Jesus is in the midst of it. And I've had many a conversation over the years as a pastor with those that are religiously engaged and yet spiritually completely blind. That's the problem that Jesus has all through the book of Mark, that the religious leaders of his day were completely blind to who he was. It's interesting in interacting with people who are spiritually blind, reminding us, so remember, we all started here at the same place. Is that sometimes you begin to deal with people down here that don't know they're spiritually blind. They don't know. You begin to talk with them, and you begin to have spiritual conversations. You work through that awkwardness, and then you find out there's a level of curiosity about them. They didn't even think about this. We are talking more and more with people that have no understanding whatsoever who Jesus is. But in their spiritual blindness, they begin to have a curiosity. There's a gentleman who I'm very fond of and love and very close to, and he and I have been having spiritual conversations for several years. And he and I were sitting across the table having a spiritual conversation, which we do almost every time we see each other. And I said to him out of frustration, I said, "It seems like you're looking for a reason not to believe." And he got quiet and put his head down, and he said to me in a whisper, he goes, no, on the contrary, I'm looking for a reason to believe. Well, there is someone that has been wrestling in their spiritual blindness, but recognizes, help me see. And maybe that's true for a lot of us in this room, that we are in that place, that we are curious, we do wonder. You've come on an arm of a friend because you are here, because you're curious. But then you have the other extreme. And the other extreme would be those that are spiritually blind and they're spiritually antagonistic in their blindness. They won't admit that they're blind. In fact, they think we're blind and we're fools. And they can do it in a very harsh and difficult way. And I've had a number of conversations over the years where I've sat down with somebody over a cup of coffee or a meal, and man, they get heated up around spiritual things. And they begin to attack and call me a bigot or intolerant or a racist or any number of things that they will come up with. A poster boy for this these days is Richard Dawkins, the British evolutionary biologist and author. He taught at Oxford for a number of years, very antagonistic. This will only increase for us as followers of Christ in our culture. We are more and more moving into a very post-Christian culture. But when I sit with somebody and someone tells me that I'm intolerant, I will look back at them and say, you know what I find interesting is that I've sat here and asked you questions and listened and sought to understand, and then I am fine with our differences as long as we're willing to talk with each other. And yet, because I have a different view of yours, you tell me I'm intolerant. Who's the intolerant one here? Who's the one that's really intolerant? And as followers of Christ, we have a responsibility to have a gracious tolerance for folks who are very different from us, to engage with them and to listen to them and ask questions and to seek them out. And we need to remind ourselves, where does this antagonism come from? Because once we understand what drives it, there's a level of grace that comes up as a result. Let me show you a verse here that's also from Corinthians, the first letter that Paul wrote to this church. Paul says, "But we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to the Jews and folly to the Christians." Folly to the Gentiles, sorry, and folly to the Gentiles. We preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to the Jews and folly to the Gentiles. It's foolishness. Soren Kierkegaard, a Danish existential philosopher, said this. Let me put it up here for you. I think it sums that up very well. It says, there are two ways to be fooled. One is to believe what isn't true. The other is to refuse to believe what is true. One is to believe what isn't true, and the other is to refuse to believe what is true. When we sit down with somebody who is wrestling with us over what we believe and we have spiritual conversations, they look at us like we're foolish. The question is it or is it true? The question is it foolishness or is it true? Our job is not to fully convince because we can't. Our job is to merely dialogue and talk and answer questions and ask good questions and let God do his work because Jesus wants us to see God is not done yet. It is the privilege of us that are followers of Jesus to engage in these spiritual conversations, these long spiritual conversations. Are you here and you're curious? We'd love to have a meal with you, have a cup of coffee, talk with you. Are you here and antagonistic? We would love to sit down and have a meal with you and have a cup of coffee with you. You will not be the first person who gets upset with me. Love to sit and chat. Love to understand what you're thinking and where you're coming from. Please reach out to one of our leaders, to Lisa, to me, to any of our deacons. We'd love to do that. That's why we're here. We as a church exist for people who are not here yet. So we'd love to have that conversation. Let me give you a couple of resources. If this is you, maybe you're curious, maybe you're wondering, let me give you a couple of resources. We'll put them up here on the screen for you to take a look at. Lee Strobel has written a book called The Case for Christ. Now, Lee Strobel, it's interesting. Lee Strobel was an investigative reporter for the Chicago Tribune, an antagonistic atheist. His wife started going to church, became a follower of Christ, and it ticked him off. And so what he did, he purposed that he was going to use his investigative resources, the way that he looks at stories, and he was going to track down Christianity and disprove it for his wife. He wanted his wife back. And so The Case for Christ kind of walks through his journey and what happened as he eventually became a follower of Christ. The other book, Reasons for God, is a great book written by a cultural apologist who's a pastor in New York City and is written with the skeptic in mind. It is written for those who are wondering and questioning and don't believe. And it's great for us as followers of Christ to read and understand what are the concerns and the arguments. So I would encourage that. And then, of course, we have Alpha here that we have on a regular basis. And Alpha is a great place for you to go. You can ask any question you want. It's a place where the gospel, what we call the good news of Jesus Christ, as the grace that God has given us through the work and the life of Jesus, is discussed. And we walk through what that means. And you can poke holes. You can kick the tires. You can challenge. We love to have people like you being a part of that, so let you know that's there. Let me sum up this one with this quote from Blaise Pascal. who lived in the 1600s. He's a French mathematician. In fact, he invented the first mechanical calculator. He says, in faith, there's enough light for those who want to believe and enough shadow to blind those who don't. In faith, there's enough light for those who want to believe and enough shadows to blind those who don't. Bottom line, Jesus wants to open your eyes. Look with me at verse 23. And he took the blind man by the hand and led him out of the village. And when he had spit on his eyes and laid his hands on him, he asked him, do you see anything? And he looked up and said, I see people, but they look like trees. Here's where we get to the crux of the story for the disciples. Because Jesus is saying to the disciples, that's how you see me right now. You've been exposed to the miracles of my teaching, but this is how you see. You only partially see. You don't fully see. And there's many of us sitting in this room are just like this. Let me sum it up this way. We might have made a decision to come to church, a decision to be engaged in a small group, a decision to serve because we like the mission of the church, like us connecting with World Vision and with the homeless and with the broken in our city and the at least served as we engage throughout our city through Renew Chicago. And we go, man, I like that. We like the idea of the gospel, this idea of grace being given to those that are least deserving, that grace comes and forgiveness comes to those who deal with guilt and shame, which is all of us. And we like that, and we like those kind of things. We like the community. We like the connection. But the bottom line is, we really only see Jesus in a very cloudy way. Knowing Jesus really hasn't made much of a difference. What we've done is we've maintained all the things we've currently done and just added Jesus to this. All this, oh yeah, and Jesus too. All this, and Jesus too. We have just enough faith to deceive us into thinking we're in a better place than we really are. What we have really is we think we have a fire insurance policy, Jesus Christ Mutual of Omaha. My eternity, I'm good. I'm good. We have a convenient faith and not a sacrificial faith. We're okay coming to a service or being involved in a small group or serving when it's convenient and it fits into our schedule, but we won't say no to other things to be engaged. We want the benefit of having our eyes open without any of the cost of being a follower of Jesus. How do you know if you only partially see? You have no real desire to read the Word. God's love letter written to us. God makes himself known in the pages of the Bible as he expresses who he is and who we are. His love letter, and we just go, yeah. We excuse our sin. That's just the way I am. It's really not that bad. There's other people worse than me. We have no true desire to repent, to really turn from these things and to turn to Christ. We're not experiencing true spiritual transformation, just kind of model clarification on some of our behaviors. Obedience is not a high value, and it's only done when it's convenient for us to do. And if there are opinions and desires and wants that we have, and they're in contrast to what God says in his Bible, well, forget that. This is where I'm going. Folks, listen to me. If the gospel of grace does not confront us to change, does not confront us in the way we think and the way we act, we don't understand the gospel. If this gospel of grace that is revealed to us in the life, in the death, and the resurrection of Jesus is not confronting the way we think and the way in which we live and the way in which we interact with each other, we do not understand the gospel. Our problem, like the disciples, is not that we're just partially blind, is that we don't even recognize that we're partially blind. We don't even see it because we are content right where we are. When I was in high school, I met my first authentic follower of Christ that I can remember. It's a young woman who I was crazy about. And she shared Jesus with me sitting on a stairway of her house. And I prayed a prayer that night. My prayer was simply this: all right, God, if you're real, I give you 30 days to change my life. That was my prayer. I wondered if there really was a God who was willing to be engaged. I didn't doubt the historicity of Jesus. I believe that Jesus was a real person, a good moral teacher, but I didn't doubt that. But then for the next 4 years, my life didn't change. Nothing changed. I continued to do all the things I wanted to do. I felt guilty about it. I felt a level of shame, but I didn't change. And I kept going down this way. All of this, Jesus too. And then I got to college and I met some people who were willing to have these awkward, hard conversations. And man, I am so glad they did, because they began to challenge me. I was involved in a student ministry in high school, and I was involved in a college ministry in college. But it wasn't until someone was willing to look me in the eye and say some hard things and ask some hard questions that at that point that my eyes went from being partially open to being fully opened. It was at that point when I became a follower of Christ. Remember, Jesus wants to open our eyes. Look with me at verse 25. Then Jesus laid his hands on his eyes again, and he opened his eyes, and his sight was restored, and he saw everything. Here's the word, clearly. He saw everything clearly. You know when this happens for the disciples? Post-resurrection. It is after the death and the resurrection of Jesus that they see Jesus clearly. That's why I think Peter includes this. Peter's going, man, I spent this whole time with Jesus, fascinated with him, watching his miracles, seeing his teaching, but I only saw him partially. I didn't fully get why he came. It wasn't until after Jesus died and rose from the dead that Peter was able to go, got it. Peter didn't understand the cross, and you'll see that next week. To see Jesus clearly, to see him clearly is to understand that we are loved by a God who wants us to know him. To see Jesus clearly means that we have an accurate picture of who we are. That we are sinful, rebellious people, resistant to God on our best day. That's the true condition of who we are. We are spiritually blind people because of our behavior. When we see Jesus clearly, then we see Jesus in all his goodness and glory. When we see Jesus, we begin to understand all that Jesus is. For me, it was to see Jesus as the Son of God and not just a historical figure. To see Jesus as someone that was God with a face and not just a good moral teacher. To see Jesus is to know that he is our hope. It is Jesus' death. It is what he does in his death that enables us to see clearly. That he takes that sin, he takes that rebellion, he gathers it up and he dies with it. He takes what we should have taken in order that we might be able to see. It is in knowing Jesus that I began to understand that the three most significant questions that I think a human can have is, where have I come from? Why am I here? And where am I going? Are answered. That there is a creating God who created me, that wants to have a relationship with me and wants to utilize me fully. Why I'm here, and not just to enjoy my eternity with him, but to enjoy him now. That there is a purpose. To see Jesus fully is to understand that we are known fully. Do you know how securing it is to know that Jesus knows everything about us? Everything. The good, the bad, and the ugly. There is nothing we're going to do that will ever catch him off guard. Our past, our present, and our future is known by him. You know how secure that feels to know you can go before Jesus, and he already knows? Because we spend so much of our time hiding these things from each other. We are known fully, but here's the kicker. But we are loved completely. Because we're not loved based on who we are and what we've done. We're based on the character of God. We're based on his choice to love in spite of who we are. To see Jesus fully is to begin to understand these things and what it means. It's to have our eyes opened so that we can see. To know that we don't seek to earn God's favor. Oh God, notice me in my good deeds. Notice me in the things that I do. Notice me in some way that we think it earns God's favor. Instead, we have so completely received his favor because of Jesus. We are already fully loved. He can't love us any more than he loves us in this very moment. We don't obey in order to gain brownie points from God. We don't obey in order for God to delight in us more than others. Now we obey because we are so fully delighted in that it is our response to his love. We seek to obey. We seek to serve. Again, not because we somehow want to be noticed, but because we have been served, that Jesus has come and served us in the most significant way in giving his life, and now we turn around and serve others in his name. We read the Bible not to gain information, but because as we read the word, we engage with the living God, the person of Jesus. And in knowing him, because we are with him, we become spiritually transformed, because the more we're with him, the more we become like him. When we see him clearly, we respond to other people very differently. We live toward others graciously. We're far more patient with those that don't hold our views. What's interesting right now is that we are in a strange and interesting political climate, aren't we? To say the least. And as a church, over the last couple years, we've been speaking out more and more about how, as Christians, do we think about the various things that we encounter in culture? And as we've talked about these things over the last several weeks, it has bothered some of us. I've received more emails and more people have stopped me and asked to talk over the things that we've said than ever before. Some of you think we're way too much like a Democrat. And then some of you think we're way too much like a Republican, which just cracks me up. And all we're trying to do is, how do we think well? How do we live with others who don't hold our views? Because the power of the gospel enables us to sit with others who don't agree with us, to hear them out, to listen well, to engage in civil conversation, and to be able to say, we still love you. When we see Jesus clearly, that begins to affect who we are and how we respond. Look with me at verse 26, and we'll end here. Jesus sent him to his home saying, don't go back through the village. You just go straight home. Because in going home, they're going to see you, and they're going to ask questions of you. And when you and I move from spiritual blindness, and we begin to see, and we see Jesus for all he is and who we are, which is really merely the beginning of the journey, not the end, it causes a curiosity in other people. We go back to our villages, so to speak, back to our circles of friends, back to our coworkers, back to our roommates and our families and our neighbors and our increasing circles of influence. We go with the story because people can't argue with your story. Folks, there's some of us sitting here that are spiritually blind. But God in his kindness has connected the spiritual dots. You know, I use that metaphor. You know what that means? When I was a little kid, I used to love to get those things where they had the numbers and the dots, and then you would just draw from 1 to 2, 2 to 3, 3 to 4, and all of a sudden it's Daffy Duck. Well, spiritually, that happens too in our spiritual blindness. God begins to connect the dots until we look up and we go, it's Jesus. And we see who we are, and we see who he is. And for some of you, God has connected the dots to the point where you're able to go, I'm in. I want to be a follower of his. And for many of us sitting here, we're in that middle piece that we've made a decision. We are part of a church. We're engaged in a small group or even serving. And yet we only have a partial understanding. We don't have a full understanding. We don't see ourselves clearly. We don't see Jesus clearly. But hopefully today, right here, right now, the Spirit of God has begun to connect those dots for you. The Spirit of God has enabled you to see clear. And today, right here, right now, you need to finish this out. Today, right here, right now, February 5th, 2017, it is time for you to become a follower of Jesus, for your life to come under new ownership and to see Jesus as your leader and your forgiver. And we want to give you an opportunity to do that. So in just a moment, I'm going to put a slide up here that has a prayer on it. And if this is something that you want to do today, become a follower of Jesus, I'm going to encourage you to read through that prayer and read that prayer back to God. All you got to do is say, God, man, this is real for me. There is nothing magical in these words. The power comes by your faith in believing these things to be true. And in the moment you begin to read, God is rushing to you to engage with you. So let's put that prayer up. And I'm going to give you some time just to read this, and then I'll close us. Let's bow our heads. I want to give you a chance to courageously respond right here, right now. That if you read that prayer, and that is the true desire of your heart right here in this moment, with our heads bowed, I just want you to lift your hand. For you to start your journey with Jesus right here. Just want you to raise your hand right where you are. I'm not going to draw this out. We're not going to sing 600 stanzas of Just As I Am. But I have been where you have been, and I know the battle that is going on with some of you. So right here, right now, if this is true for you, I just want you to lift your hand. Father God, we thank you that right now, Luke 15 tells us, there is a party in heaven over those that right now, right here, have become a follower of your Son. The angels are rejoicing that you have brought people from spiritual blindness to a place where they see Jesus clearly. And we rejoice with them, Father God. We thank you. We thank you for how you've taken all of us in this room that are followers of your Son from spiritual blindness to a place that we see Jesus clearly. You are a good and gracious God, doing for us what we could never do for ourselves. In Jesus' name we pray.